Good morning, good morning. Good morning, good morning. We are so excited that you are here this morning at First Baptist Dothan. We know that on a beautiful, soon-to-be rainy spring day, you have a lot of other opportunities, and so we always appreciate getting to worship together on Sunday. So we have a couple of exciting things happening in the life of our church today. We are going to be celebrating baptism in a few moments, but today is also an exciting day because we are welcoming Amanda and Stephen Wilder. I think Stephen's in here, and Amanda, who is our new children's minister, is already making sure that everything is all squared away, so she has jumped right in with both feet, and so we'll make sure that y'all get to meet them at the end of the service, but we want to welcome them, so if you want to give them a round of applause, Amanda will hear you from the nursery. Stephen will pass that along. So we have a couple of really exciting things happening today, and then next week, Palm Sunday, a week before Easter, we have another couple of exciting things. Right after the worship service, we will have a jambalaya fellowship and dessert auction, all of the proceeds of which will go to help offset costs for our student mission trips and camp over the summer. So if you would like to reserve your plate of jambalaya, or we have a limited amount of pans of jambalaya for those of you who like to buy in bulk, you can do that by going to fbcdothan.org/events. You can also pay at the door next week. So we will just leave the worship service next week, and that will be in the dining hall. We'll have a lot of great homemade desserts made by many of you in this room, and it's going to be a really good time of fellowship, and it's going to be a really good time for us to get to raise some money to help offset costs for our students over the summer. And just because Palm Sunday wouldn't be complete if it wasn't totally full that evening, we will also have our quarterly members meeting, and that will be at 5 o'clock in the chapel. And so that will be followed up by a potluck. And so Palm Sunday will be full of fellowship and fun and us getting to spend time together. So as we begin our time of worship together, we will have our call to worship.
For our call to worship, I will read from Psalm 145, verses 1 through 13. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works I will meditate. They shall speak of the night of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works. This is the word of the Lord. Please join me in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we acknowledge you and honor you as the one true God, the holy and perfect creator, the sovereign ruler, the righteous judge, the loving Father. We honor you for who you are, and we thank you for what you have done for us. Thank you for sending your Son to die for our sins, that we might have eternal life with you in heaven. Thank you for sending the Holy Spirit to live within the heart of the believer, that we can grow in the likeness of Christ. Thank you for giving us the Holy Scriptures, your word, that is a light into our path, that points us to Christ. Thank you for your holy church, the body of Christ, of which we are a part. And we thank you for this local congregation and pray that you help us to do the work that you have prepared beforehand for us to do, and that we will be found faithful by those who come behind us. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Well, we just read Psalm 145. Alan has prayed through Psalm 145. Now let's stand and sing together Psalm 145.
Visiting different churches with my friends' families. All I didn't do the right thing very often. I was God-fearing, all right, as in afraid to be around him, talk to him, and confess to him. I wanted to hide from him as much as possible, like Adam did after the fall, when the Lord called out to him in the garden. I was ashamed of who I was in God's eyes. I met my wife, Amber, almost 10 years ago now. I truly believe that God sent her to me to bring me to him, to bring to him. It was only after meeting her that I started to attend church, read, follow, and understand Scripture and the gospel. The more I learned about Jesus and the good news, the more I wanted a relationship with him and for him to be a part of every aspect of my life. I now understood that I am a sinner and that God sent Jesus to die for my sin so that faith in Christ would be my eternal salvation with the one and only Father. To symbolize my faith in Christ, I want to be buried in my sin and rise in the freedom of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Faith, as my brother in Christ, it's my privilege this morning to baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk with you.
Sing together as we continue to praise God for the good things that He's done.
Reaches of heaven, starry eyes, lights of the evening, dancing in silent skies, brilliance of morning, breaking the day, oh let them praise Him. Oh, praise His name,
it together one more time.
Oh, praise His name. Oh, praise His name. Let all His wondrous works declare His praise. Oh, praise His name. Oh, praise His name. Let all His wondrous works declare.
Please be seated.
At this time, I want to invite all the children to come up here and sit with me just for a few minutes as we discuss the sermon for today. And I had to change very quickly to make this happen. While our kids are coming down from the balcony and everywhere else, I just want to do an experiment this morning with the congregation. If you were converted to faith in Christ between the ages of 5 and 12 this morning, would you stand? If you were converted to faith in Christ between the ages of 5 and 12. And I want everybody to look around the room. What we teach our children matters tremendously. You may be seated. Boys and girls, this morning, as we have a few more probably trickle down to join us, this morning we're continuing our study of the book of Isaiah. And today in Isaiah 47, the prophet is speaking not to Israel. Hey, Trent, come on in. Not to Israel in this specific instance, but he's actually talking to the nation of Babylon. And as we've been learning for the last couple of months, God used the nation of Babylon to actually discipline Israel. They came in and they destroyed the temple and they took the people of Israel, and they took them back to Babylon, so they were put in exile. But today in our sermon, God is actually going to be teaching the Babylonians that they were only an instrument that God used in order to discipline His people. Specifically, what I want you guys to know from the sermon today comes from verse 4. Here's what it says. Our Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, is His name. He is the Holy One of Israel. Have you ever heard of the term Redeemer before? If you have, raise your hand. We talk about this term all the time. But does anybody actually know what it means when we say that God is our Redeemer? Any guesses? What do you think it means?
He redeems our
soul. Exactly. He redeems our soul. He redeems us from our sin. The term actually means that He basically purchases us. He brings us back. So, Coy, come over here and stand with me for a moment. I'm going to give you a dollar bill, Barrett. You don't get to keep it. Coy, come sit with me right here. In ancient times, it was very common for owners of slaves to redeem their servants. So let's say that Coy was taken from you, and he was even traded to another landowner, but you wanted to redeem him. So Barrett, you would actually redeem him by purchasing the rights for Coy. And oftentimes how you would do that would be through money. Thank you. I told you I wasn't going to let you keep it. So this term of redeeming was often in the relationship between an owner and a slave. But God is our Redeemer because you and I are enslaved to what? Sin, right? And so God actually purchases us back. And you know how He does that? Through Jesus. Jesus specifically is our Redeemer. When He dies on the cross, He actually makes the decision to die in our place for our sin. And through His death, He redeems us back to God. And so today in our sermon, we're going to be talking about how God not only redeems us from our sin, but in the history of Israel, He redeemed them from the nation of Babylon. He brought them back again to be a part of His kingdom. So that's what I want you to think about as we study the text this morning, is that God is our Redeemer. As we continue on in worship this morning, Hank is going to pray for us, our offertory prayer, and then you can go back and be seated with your families.
Dear God, we come to you this morning, and we thank you, God. We thank you for being our Redeemer and our Savior, God. God, we thank you for today. We thank you for your provision that you have given us. As we come into our time where we give back a portion of what you have provided. In Jesus' name, amen.
As we continue our study of Isaiah, last week we were reminded that Yahweh is the one true God. He is the creator, the sustainer of life. He is the imperishable, immortal, invisible, unbegotten, all-knowing, all-powerful ruler of the universe. We looked at his characteristics, his attributes, what sets Yahweh apart from every other false god that existed in the time of Babylon and that still exists today. The gods of Babylon were none of those attributes. They were man-made. They were housed within shrines. And even though Babylon is the instrument that God is using to discipline his people, this in no way excused their idolatry and their polytheism. And as we come to chapter 47, as I told the children earlier, this entire chapter is an indictment on the nation of Babylon for their failure to acknowledge Yahweh as the one true God. Now, you have heard the saying before that pride comes before the fall. This is the idea that people and teams, organizations, institutions that think they are invincible inevitably will come crashing down. Now, in the biblical narrative, this is true of Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Persia, and Rome. In world history, more recently, this has been true of the Soviet Union and Germany. In our own history as a nation, Great Britain during the American Revolution. In sports, which would be my specialty, I can think of watching in 2001 the Arizona Diamondbacks against the New York Yankees. Now, if you know anything about Major League Baseball, the Yankees had won the previous three World Series. And nobody thought that this up-and-coming expansion team out of Phoenix was going to defeat the New York Yankees in the World Series. But they did it. It was one of the best series in World Series history. Some of you might remember where you were when the New England Patriots played the New York Giants in Super Bowl 42. They were going for a perfect season, which had not been done since the Miami Dolphins in 1972. No one thought the Giants stood a chance. They were 10-6 that year. They snuck in the playoffs, and ultimately, they take down the New England Patriots in one of the biggest upsets in Super Bowl history. If you follow the Olympics, you probably remember, if you were alive, in 1980, the Miracle on Ice, when the American hockey team defeated the Soviet Union, who had won the previous four gold medals and were heavily favored in that game. In our text today, Babylon is the equivalent here of the Patriots, of the Soviet Union, of Germany. It seemed like their power and their prestige would never come to an end. They were not only confident in their power, but they were actually arrogant in their power. And this entire chapter, chapter 47, is directed specifically at the nation of Babylon. So let's begin reading in verse 1. Isaiah, speaking as the mouthpiece of God, says, "Come down and sit in the dust, O virgin daughter of Babylon. Sit on the ground without a throne, O daughter of the Chaldeans. For you shall no more be called tender and delicate. Take the millstones and grind flour. Put off your veil. Strip off your robe. Uncover your legs. Pass through the rivers. Your nakedness shall be uncovered, and your disgrace shall be seen. I will take vengeance, and I will spare no one. Our Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, is his name. He is the Holy One of Israel. Sit in silence and go in the darkness, O daughter of the Chaldeans, for you shall no more be called the mistress of kingdoms. I was angry with my people. I profaned my heritage. I gave them into your hand. You showed them no mercy. On the aged, you made your yoke exceedingly heavy. You said, I shall be mistress forever, so that you did not lay these things to heart or remember their end. Now, therefore, hear this. You lover of pleasures, who sit securely, who say in your heart, I am, and there is no one besides me. I shall not sit as a widow or know the loss of children. These two things shall come to you in a moment, in one day. The loss of children and widowhood shall come upon you in full measure, in spite of your many sorceries and the great power of your enchantments. You felt secure in your wickedness. You said, no one sees me. Your wisdom and your knowledge led you astray. And you said in your heart, I am, and there is no one besides me. But evil shall come upon you, when you will not know how to turn away. Disaster shall fall upon you, for which you will not be able to atone, and ruin shall come upon you suddenly, of which you know nothing. Stand fast in your enchantments and your many sorceries, with which you have labored from your youth. Perhaps you may be able to succeed. Perhaps you may inspire terror. You are wearied with your many counsels. Let them stand forth and save you. Those who divide the heavens, who gaze at the stars, who at the new moons make known what shall come upon you. Behold, they are like stubble. The fire consumes them. They cannot deliver themselves from the power of the flame. No coal for warming oneself is this. No fire to sit before. Such to you are those with whom you have labored, who have done business with you from your youth. They wander about, each in his own direction. There is no one to save you. From this text this morning, I want to point out to you two truths or two observations. Number one, the consequences of Babylon's pride. And number two, the failure of Babylon's religion. The consequence of Babylon's pride and the failure of Babylon's religion. And as we read this text, we might be prone to think that this is Babylon. It doesn't apply to us. But we are prone to pride and false religion in the same way this ancient nation was many years ago. So this text is applicable and it is relevant to us. Number one, the consequences of Babylon's pride. Isaiah calls out to Babylon to come down, he says. Get off your high horse. He tells them to sit in the dust. This reminds us all the way back in Genesis chapter 2:7, when we learn that Adam was formed from the dust of the earth. It is used throughout Scripture to signify man's weakness and man's frailty. David tells us in Psalm 103:14 that God remembers that we are dust. He tells the daughters of the Chaldeans to sit on the ground without a throne, tender and delicate, is being described here as a way to say that Babylon has never really experienced any hardship as a nation. They had been a pristine nation, untouched by the cares of the world. But Isaiah is telling them here, their time of trial is coming. The description that we have in verses 2 and 3 spares all pleasantries. Working at the millstones means nothing to us. But in ancient times, it was considered the lowest form of slavery. Removing the veil, stripping the robe, uncovering the legs would have been rightly understood as shameful and embarrassing things to endure. A veil and a robe were qualities that would have described the upper class. And Isaiah is telling Babylon here, this is no longer going to describe you. This is who you were at one time. But when God's judgment comes, you will no longer be described in this way. You will lose all of your status. You will lose your possessions. You will lose your wealth. Uncovering nakedness is a sign of humiliation, if you remember the story all the way back in Genesis, where one of Noah's sons walks in on his nakedness, and he is cursed for it. And the other two sons walk in and cover him up, facing backwards. So to view anyone in this way was a sign of shame and humiliation. God is communicating through Isaiah here that Babylon will face his judgment. Who is going to be the one to do this? We learn in verse 4. It's the Redeemer. It's the Lord of hosts. Now in Isaiah chapter 40, all the way through 46, we have been left wondering if God was going to intervene for his people. From the very beginning, we were asking these questions. Does God still care about Israel? Will he remain faithful to Israel in spite of their sin? The covenant that he established with them all the way back in Genesis 12, would he maintain faithfulness to it? And we're learning right here in this verse that God has not forgotten his people. He is their Redeemer. He has not abandoned them because of their sin. He is faithful to the covenant that he made with them many, many years ago. Was God angry with his people? Yes. Did God give his people over to the Babylonians because of their disobedience? Yes. But through the process of God handing over his people to this nation, instead of the Babylonians becoming reliant on Yahweh, they only became more reliant on their own strength and their own gods. And we are reminded here of what I talked to the children about this morning, that Yahweh is our Redeemer. In Jeremiah's prophecy, he had already said that Israel would be in exile for 70 years. And it's not because of anything Babylon did, but rather it was to fulfill the word of the Lord. God had told his people, you will experience consequences because of your disobedience. But now, in this passage, God is ready to begin the process of redeeming his chosen people back to himself. This idea of redemption is not only found in Isaiah, but it is found across the entire biblical narrative. Due to our sin, we are enslaved to our flesh. We are under the oppression of sin. Much like Babylon was oppressing the nation of Israel in this passage. But as we come closer to the Easter season, we are reminded that through the death of Christ, we have been redeemed by his blood. For all of those that repent of sin and place their faith in Christ, the kingdom of darkness is not what they're known for anymore. They are known by the righteous shed blood of Jesus on their behalf. So we are redeemed, brothers and sisters, from our enslavement to sin, so that we are free now to serve Christ. Israel was not being released from exile to live however they wanted. They were being freed to return to the way that God designed them to live from the very beginning, when he created all of humanity in Genesis 1 and 2. Freedom in Christ doesn't mean the freedom to live however we want. That is not what Paul is teaching in the book of Romans. It means the freedom to live the way that God originally designed us to live. Israel's exile was ultimately a teaching moment for them. God was telling them, you have not been living the way that I designed for you to live. It's like they were living under a different kingdom. So what does God do? He gives them a different kingdom. He sends them off to Babylon. And once they realize that Yahweh was in fact a loving, caring, thoughtful king, most of the people wanted out of Babylon. They wanted to come back under the lordship of Yahweh. So if you're here today and you are not in Christ, you are living under the kingdom of darkness. You are living under the oppression of sin and the devil. You might think that you have freedom apart from Christ, because somewhere along the way, the devil has deceived you into understanding the world's concept of freedom rather than the Bible's concept of freedom. A book I just recently finished, focusing on the atonement of Christ, Jeremy Treat, this is what he says about freedom. He says, according to our culture, freedom is being able to do whatever you want. It is the removal of constraints and the absence of authority. The problem with this version of freedom is that it ends up being another form of slavery. That is, slavery to your own desires. True freedom is not being able to do whatever you want. It is being able to do that for which you were made. Jesus is the only one who can set us free, redeeming us from our sin and for a life in his kingdom. The freedom that Babylon was operating with aligns with this idea of freedom as removal of all constraints and absence of all authority. They themselves were acting as God. Look at verse 8. Now therefore, hear this, you lover of pleasures, who sit securely, who say in your heart, I am, and there is no one besides me. I shall not sit as a widow or know the loss of children. And then in verse 10, you felt secure in your wickedness. You said, no one sees me. Your wisdom and your knowledge led you astray. And you said in your heart, I am, and there is no one besides me. Now, if you've been paying attention in chapters 40 through 46, we have read over and over again Isaiah telling us that Yahweh is the only God, and there is no one besides him. We've seen it in almost every chapter. But here, Isaiah describes Babylon speaking with this terminology. They thought that there was no one besides them. They thought that they didn't need God. They themselves were acting as God. Babylon is saying here that there is no one like them as a nation. They are defying God. They are defying authority over his creation. And the consequences for this defying his authority will be the loss of children and widowhood in one moment, in one day, verse 9 tells us. Disaster, evil, and ruin will come upon them, according to verse 11. So the application for us is one of humility. Perhaps some of you in this room who are students, you excel at school, or you excel at sports. You must remember that it is God who has given you that mind to excel academically. It is God who has given you that body to excel athletically. Adults, those of us who consider ourselves to be successful in our careers, we are prone to think that it's our work ethic, or it's our ability to manage people, or our brains that have made us successful. But where do you think that work ethic, that brain, that ability to manage people came from? It was given to you by your Creator. And it can be taken away in a glimpse of a moment. The American ideal of the self-made man does not exist, brothers and sisters. Any success you have had is because the God of this universe gifted you to exercise gifts so that you could, in fact, have this success. And when we think we are responsible for our success, we are acting just like Babylon in this passage. As they claimed that there was no one besides them, they were the ones responsible for the success that they had had in conquering all of these nations. They were the ones who went in and conquered Jerusalem and destroyed the temple and brought the people back. When all along the biblical narrative tells us God allowed this to happen. God gave Nebuchadnezzar the strength, the organizational skill to go in and take God's people from Jerusalem and march them into exile. So Isaiah is reminding Babylon, as he reminds us, that pride is a very, very dangerous thing. But we also learn in this passage the failure of Babylon's religion. Now, in verses 12 and 13, Isaiah is using sarcasm. He's encouraging the Babylonians to remain true to their idolatrous ways for the purpose of proving his point that their gods cannot deliver. A lot of people think that the astrological phenomena was first formulated during the time of the Babylonians. They studied the movements of the stars and the moon. They believed that they could predict earthly events based on their observations. Enchantments were used to predict the future and control the outcome of events. And Isaiah tells them, it's time for these people to step up and save you. Now is their time to shine. Of course, we know the answer to this. They will not deliver. They have the opportunity to prove that their gods can save them from this impending judgment that Yahweh is bringing upon them. But Isaiah knows all along they will not answer to this challenge because they have no power. these astrologers, these sorcerers are not able to save the Babylonians. Bel and Nebo that we studied last week in chapter 46, these great gods of Babylon were ultimately constructed by men, carried by animals, placed into shrines. This has all been done by humans. These gods are man-made. They are perishable. They are created. But we learned last week that Yahweh is none of those things. He is imperishable. He never fades. He never tarnishes. He's all-powerful, all-knowing. So as Isaiah challenges these false gods in Babylon, he finally says that they're all stubble. These magicians that Babylon looked to control worldly events, to save them potentially from Yahweh's judgment, they are worthless. They will not be spared, Isaiah says, from the power of the flame. I can't help but think as I read here in Isaiah 47, the great story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel chapter 3. This is what they say. O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego knew that Yahweh had the power to save them, even if he chose not to. In contrast, the magicians, the astrologers, these gods of Babylon could save no one from the fiery flames that would come. And this fire, Isaiah says, is not a campfire to keep you warm. It will be an intense judgment. Where will these magicians be on the day of judgment? Isaiah tells us in verse 15, they'll be gone. They will abandon their posts. They wander about, he says, each in his own direction. There is no one to save them. This is the point of these final verses. Babylon needed a true savior, and instead they chose a phony one. The failure of Babylon's religion is ultimately the failure of all religions outside of Christianity. Tim Keller always used to talk about this in his books and in his sermons and in his lectures. The difference between the gospel and religion. And here are some of the differences. He said, in religion, we obey so that we can be accepted. But in the gospel, we are accepted, and therefore we obey. In religion, he said, obedience is done to get things from God. But in the gospel, obedience is done to get God, to delight and resemble him. In religion, motivation is based on fear and insecurity. But in the gospel, motivation is based on grateful joy for what God has done for us. In religion, prayer consists largely of petition and only heats up when we have needs. But in the gospel, prayer consists of generous stretches of praise and adoration because the purpose of prayer is fellowship with God. These are the differences that exist between the gospel of Jesus Christ and between religion. And for Babylon, it all described religion. They were putting their faith and trust in these false gods to give them a hope and to give them a future. And Isaiah is telling them here, when you need these gods in your moment of trial, they will not be there for you. They will run away. They are like stubble. They will wander. You will never find them. Now, you and I are probably not prone, at least I hope, to read our horoscopes every week or to look to magicians to predict the future for us. But we are prone, brothers and sisters, to search for a savior in all of the wrong places. And these false saviors cannot deliver. They didn't deliver Babylon in their time of need. They never delivered for Israel in their time of need. They do not deliver for the church in their time of need. And they will not deliver for you and me personally in our time of need. Jesus is the only one who can save us. In our passage, Babylon needed someone to save them from their earthly circumstances. And I want to be clear this morning that following Jesus does not guarantee that your earthly circumstances will improve. You will still face trial. You will still suffer. You will grieve. You will mourn. And ultimately, you still will die. But the hope of the gospel is that your suffering, your grief, your hurt, and your death do not define you. In the gospel, the righteousness of God in you gives you a hope and a future in the presence of God Himself. Babylon was so consumed with the things of this world that they were blinded to the fact that their magicians and their gods were only of this world. But all Christians serve a transcendent God who reigns over the entire creation and is separate from us in many of His attributes, but He is imminent towards us through the sending of His Son to live a fully human life while remaining fully God in the process. Only Yahweh can redeem a people to Himself. And for you and me, through the new covenant, that comes through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth. Isaiah is telling Babylon, your gods cannot save you. Your military strength will not save you. Your magicians, your astrologers, the sun, the moon, and the stars, none of these things at the end of the day can prevent God's judgment from taking place in your life. Lost people that are present today, hear me this morning. You can have a relationship with God. And it doesn't come through any of the gods that we've talked about this morning or any other god that is promoted in culture, whether that be money, fame, possessions, career, family. The only one that can redeem you, the only one that can purchase you back from a life of sin and death is Jesus Himself. That is the message of the gospel. But if we continue, Christians or non-Christians for that matter, if we continue to put our focus and our trust in the things of this world, they will always disappoint. They will never live up to the perfection of what God accomplished through the sending of Jesus to die in our place for our sin, so that any who turn from their sin and place their faith in Christ can be reconciled to a holy God. Yahweh is our Redeemer. He is the one who saves us from our sin. And the failure of Babylon's religion and the pride with which they exhibit in these passages should point us ultimately to the one true Savior Himself, Jesus Christ. Let's pray. God, we are all prone to look to false gods to give us purpose, to give us contentment, to give us fulfillment in life. But God, your word is very clear. That only comes through Christ. For any that are here today that have never turned from their sin and placed their faith in Christ, I pray that your Spirit would do the work of taking the seeds that have been planted through the preaching of your word, and that fruit would develop as a result. And for those of us in Christ, may we continue, as we have done throughout this series, to examine our own hearts, to look for false gods that we worship, and to turn from them, and to recommit to placing our focus on you. You are a great God. who has redeemed a people to yourself. And because of that, you are worthy of our worship and our praise. It's in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray all of these things. Amen. As we conclude our service today, we're going to stand together now and continue to praise God for what he has done through the preaching of his word. Let's stand together now as we sing.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Amen. Our benediction comes from 2 Corinthians. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Go now in peace.